This video is sponsored by Charity Stars. Commercial solar energy is experiencing a boom as technology improves and prices continue to drop year after year. But even today in 2022, a lot of homeowners are still on the fence. Aging home infrastructure and high upfront costs are a major deterrent for going solar. So what if we could produce solar panels that were 3 times lighter, 3 times cheaper than today's traditional solar panels? And what if we could make them by using plain old industrial printers? While this technology may sound too good to be true, it's actually in development right now thanks to Professor Paul Destour and a team of researchers at the University of Newcastle in Australia. After over 15 years in the lab, Destour and his team recently partnered with CHEP, an Australian shipping supply company, as part of a pilot program to test their ink-printed solar panels in the real world. The key innovation is a semiconducting liquid ink that can go inside a standard inkjet printer. The liquid is then literally printed onto the sheets of polyethylene one layer after another until the cells are about 200 microns thick, 3 times the thickness of a single strand of hair. The cells then get a layer of aluminum before they're laminated to protect them from damage. The final product actually kind of looks like a bag of potato chips. It's possible that down the road, the liquid itself could be applied to all kinds of surfaces like roof tiles, walls, glass, and even steel. Eventually, these printed solar panels could be embedded into buildings or windows. But that's putting the cart a little before the horse. This process makes these panels incredibly easy to produce. With the university's small-scale printers, which were originally used to make wine labels, they're able to output hundreds of meters per day. Upgrading to a commercial-scale printer could increase output from meters to kilometers a day. One benefit of this insane production speed is that the cells can be made in large quantities on demand. This could have far-reaching implications in terms of disaster response and preparedness. Imagine during a natural disaster being able to supply hundreds of meters of solar cells in a matter of hours. The panels are also extremely lightweight, about 300 times lighter than traditional cells. A typical solar panel can weigh up to 42 pounds, and that's not even including installation hardware. This could make them an incredibly attractive feature for older homes whose roofs might not be able to support the weight of traditional installations. It's one thing to have to consider the upfront cost of a solar installation, but if you have to re-roof your home first, forget about it. These printed panels are so light, they can stick to just about any roof using double-sided tape. For the pilot program, a system totaling 640 meters of material was installed by a team of 5 in just 1 day. And as an added bonus, being made of over 99% PET materials, the panels are almost entirely recyclable, a distinct advantage over traditional silicon panels. But the real question is, how do these panels perform compared to traditional solar panels? The first thing to look at, of course, is energy efficiency. Of the sun's energy that hits these panels, how much is actually converted into electricity? Today, the most commonly used solar panels are monocrystalline silicon panels. The hard truth is that even the most efficient panels operate only at about 22% efficiency, meaning that even sitting all day in direct sunlight, less than a quarter of that light gets converted into usable energy. And that's sort of the best case scenario. Most panels actually run somewhere between 15 and 20% efficiency. Now, that's not meant to be a knock on solar panels. Obviously, we're all about that solar life. But as we've covered on this channel and many other videos, one of the big challenges engineers face when it comes to solar is increasing that efficiency. So how do these printed panels stack up in terms of efficiency? Well, based on figures from the pilot program, not great. In fact, it's pretty dismal, maxing out at around 3% efficiency. What would that mean in terms of energy output? Let's look at a typical panel with a surface area of 2 meters squared. And yes, size in this case does matter, but we'll explain why in a bit. So let's say this panel running at between 15 and 20% efficiency puts out about 330 watts. If that panel gets 8 hours of sunlight a day, it will produce around 2.8 kilowatt hours per day. A printed panel of the same size running at around 3% efficiency and getting the same amount of sunlight will produce only about 20 to 30 watts, which amounts to between 0.16 and 0.24 kilowatt hours per day. That means to generate the same amount of power, you'd need 10 to 15 times the amount of surface area. But it doesn't stop there. In terms of longevity, traditional panels can last well over 30 years. Right now, these printed panels are only expected to last between 1 and 2 years. Again, not even close. So, case closed, right? These panels are a dud. If they don't last as long and they don't produce anywhere close to the same amount of energy, why even bother? Well, now it's time to think like an engineer. So while no, the printed solar panels can't even come close to competing with traditional panels in terms of efficiency, that's not the whole story. I mean, how cool would it be if you could print these out and put them on your house or your electric car? which is a perfect segue to our sponsor this week, Charity Stars. I partnered with Charity Stars because I love a good win-win. Use our link charitystars.com/2bit for an extra 500 entries for a chance to win a Tesla Model S Plaid and support a worthy cause at the same time. One tree planted. The Tesla Model S Plaid is absolutely bonkers, with 3 electric motors, 1,020 horsepower, and 0-60 times in just 2 seconds. Throw in its world-class infotainment system, 22-speaker audio system, 390 miles of electric range, and seating for 5, and it's fit for a family or the racetrack. You'll also be supporting an amazing cause. One Tree Planted will plant one tree for every dollar donated. Since 2014, they have planted over 40 million trees in more than 43 countries around the world. They believe that together we can reforest the planet, create habitats for biodiversity, and make a positive social impact around the world. So use my link, www.charitystars.com/2bit, coupon code 2bit, to enter for your chance to win and get 500 extra entries. Huge thanks to Charity Stars and you for supporting the companies that support the show. Let's look back at the 330-watt panels from before. Right now, the Solar Energy Industries Association estimates the national average cost of a residential solar panel system is between $2.66 to $2.94 per watt. But here in San Diego, where I live, it's maybe closer to $3 per watt. For the average homeowner to install a smaller solar system, a 2.8 kilowatt system, about 8 of these 330 watt panels, would cost about $8,400 before tax credits. So a single 2 square meter panel producing 330 watts at $3 per watt would cost about $990 or $495 per meter squared. Typically, you don't measure panel cost or efficiency in terms of surface area. But since that's how the printed panels are made, it's more of an applicable metric. So these numbers are really just approximations, but stick with us. Now let's look at the printed panels. Right now, the developers are able to produce panels at less than $10 per square meter. That means to produce a 2 meter squared 10 to 15 watt panel would cost roughly $20, which comes out to only 75 cents per watt. But Ricky, wouldn't you need to have 10 to 15 times the amount of surface area to get the same amount of energy? Yes, so what would that look like? Remember, we said to generate 2.8 kilowatts, you would need 8 traditional panels measuring about 2 meters squared each, taking up a total surface area of 16 meters squared. The pilot system used about 640 total meters of printed solar panels connected to form a 200 square meter bank, and the total cost of the project, about $2,000. This is where the technology could truly be competitive. At scale, the price per watt is still significantly cheaper. Now, of course, there is still one glaring problem. Could most residential roofs even support 200 square meters of solar panel area? And that's up for debate. Here in San Diego, the average home is about 2,400 square feet, or about 240 square meters. Now, the size of a roof will vary from house to house, but generally speaking, the roof surface area is greater than your floor space area. So a 240 meter squared floor plan will have at least 240 meters of roof area, if not more. But the problem is not all of that area is going to be facing the direction that you want. For example, in the northern hemisphere, you'd want the southern part of your roof, the south-facing part. And that could easily cut the amount of available roof area in half. So might you have enough area for all of these printed panels? Maybe. So while these printed solar panels in their current form are significantly less efficient than traditional panels, they are exponentially cheaper. And since they are so lightweight and easy to apply, requiring no racks or mounts, you could theoretically outfit your entire roof with panels for about a quarter of the price of a typical solar installation. And even if they may not be the perfect fit for every home, they could certainly benefit businesses whose buildings have huge amounts of roof area. There is still one other major problem, though, and that's how long these printed panels will last. A lifetime of 1 to 2 years just doesn't make sense for most applications, because you got to remember the biggest part about the cost is typically labor. And while these panels don't have all the racking and mounting that you would need for traditional panels, you do need somebody to go up there and replace them every 2 years. That will completely wipe out any savings you might have. So really, for this application and for this technology to be even worth recommending or to get excited about, I think the lifetimes need to be up over 5 to 10 years, and the efficiency, if they could double or triple that, now we're cooking. But as it stands right now, it's really more of a niche product for very specific applications. Now, we mentioned at the beginning that for emergencies, this could really make sense. If there was a tornado or a hurricane and huge communities were without power, imagine being able to roll these out on top of roofs or even on the ground to produce energy in a pinch, especially when you have people in homes that need electricity for medical equipment and things. It could be really life-saving stuff. But that lifespan is just too short for any real commercial application today, in my opinion. But I really hope these guys keep at it and they can get these numbers up. Still, Dastoor and his team recognize the need to produce more efficient panels before hitting the market. But though development is still ongoing, this step in commercial applications is major. The team currently estimates that Australia could see these panels hitting the market in just 2 years. Over the last decade or so, we've seen solar not only get significantly more efficient, but exponentially cheaper. And with this product already proven in the lab and making its way into actual real-world testing, this might just be one of those future things that you should get excited about. The team is already exploring ways to make the technology even more efficient, including experimenting with perovskite materials, an alternative to silicon that has the potential to significantly increase solar efficiency. We've actually already done a deep dive on perovskite solar, which we will link to here. One final application you might be thinking about is if you could print these panels and put them on cars, that would be pretty cool. But again, that 2-year lifespan is the limiting factor. So I really hope these guys can get that up to closer to 5 or 10 years, and we can pretty much put solar on anything. And if you're interested in learning more about the emerging technology that can save you time, money, and energy, consider subscribing to this channel. As always, thank you so much for joining me. I'm Ricky with Tuba DaVinci, and we'll catch you guys next week.